Greetings, fellow investigators, and welcome to our video podcast, Into the Darkness, where my friends and I play the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. I'm your host, Tom Rayleigh. Our game master, Jeff Wilkins, has chosen an excellent adventure for us directly from the 7th edition of the Call of Cthulhu Keeper's Rulebook. It's entitled Amidst the Ancient Trees and was written by Matthew Sanderson. So, grab some popcorn, turn down the lights. The players are ready. Let's begin our journey into the darkness. Jeff?
Thanks, Tom.
All right.
So just a quick little blurb first, just a quick overview. The small town in southern Vermont called Bennington. Time is 1925. It's around mid to late September. The days are still hot, but the nights can get kind of chilly. There's been a disturbing event that has shaken up the entire town. Basically, there's been a kidnapping. One of the bigwigs of the town, he's actually on the water department. His name is Lucas Strong. His daughter, 16-year-old daughter Jane, was kidnapped. There was supposed to be the exchange, the ransom exchange, on Friday night, and it went horribly wrong. The kidnappers escaped into the woods, and where our adventure is going to basically pick up is Saturday morning, where everyone's being called to the local police station or sheriff's department. And basically, you guys are going to be set up as a posse to go in and hopefully recover Jane and possibly bring the kidnappers to justice. So,
what time of year is it?
September, I believe.
Yep. Mid to late September.
1925.
Real quick, I'm just going to also make sure that my screen sharing is going to work. So, the way we've already set up our characters. Actually, let's go through that first, actually. Why don't we start? I'm going to go with, I know everybody's screen icons are different, so I'll just call you guys out. Just give me a quick, like, you know, description of your character, where you're from, and then we just probably go from there. Tom, you want to go first?
Sure. My character is Alvin Hitch. He is a mechanic who works in Bennington. He was born and raised in a garage. His father ran the Hicks garage, and so he's learned just about everything there is to know about mechanical fixing things, including tractors, just about everything that they've ever had. He's not married, and he's never really been able to find anybody, mainly because he's dirty most of the time. He's got oil on his hands, he's got dirty fingernails, he smells of engine oil. And, I mean, it's not like he keeps himself dirty, it's just, it's part of the trade. He's obviously come in because he's a member of the community, and he's got strong arms, and if they need somebody to look for somebody, he's going to help. That's it.
Cool. Let's go with Simon. You want to go next?
I'm playing Lloyd Han. I'm the local storekeeper. Late 30s, unmarried. I lived in Bennington all my life. And keeps himself to himself reasonably, but it is known that he has a card game held once a week and he's store, nothing illegal there, and if you get what moonshine, he might be able to get it for you. That's just about it, really.
Cool. Quick question. I notice on your stats you have high strength and you have a high size. are you picturing your characters being like strong, bulky, or just like heavy set?
He's more thin and but tall. Okay. Yeah, it's more hidden strength. He's not very large build.
Okay, got it.
Probably strong from lifting boxes and stuff.
Yeah. Mick, how about?
Okay, my character is Chester Tate. He's a local farmer. Like the previous two characters, he was born and raised in Bennington, like his father and grandfather before him. He knows the town like he knows the back of his hand. He's a well-regarded man with the respect of his neighbors and a reputation as the kind of man who will always help out where it's needed. He's not overly religious, but he goes to church every Sunday and he helps out with the harvest festival. He has a wife, Sarah, who he married quite young. She was his childhood sweetheart. They're happily married. They have one daughter, Evangeline, who's 13 years old. He's never left Bennington, except when he went off to war. He had quite a bad war. He himself wasn't injured or anything, but he lost quite a few good friends. And he was one of the few people who came back. He's not an overly gregarious man, but nor is he garrulous, but he'll pass the time with people, and he takes a genuine interest in the lives of his friends and neighbors. Really, he's at best when he's on his farm, and he's very attached to the farm and the house. It's where he grew up, it's where he was born, it's where he feels most at home.
Excellent. And certainly, last but not least, Mr. Wayne.
All right. I'll be playing James Murphy from Arkham, Massachusetts. He was born in Boston. He is a detective. He spent several years working for the Arkham PD, ended up becoming a private detective. And he's about 35 years old, thin, red hair, from an Irish background. And that's pretty much it.
Okay. Great. So as just kind of a story hook to bring your character into the local town of Bennington, since you're associated with the law enforcement and everything, I'm going to have the local PD from Bennington. They would have contacted you late Friday night after this all went to hell. And they're basically calling you in to help with the search. Check my screen sharing here. They're going to put you up in a local hotel.
Okay.
Is that working? Okay. You guys see that?
Yeah.
It's known as the Walloon Sack Inn.
Ooh.
Walloon Sack Inn.
Currently owned by Walter Berry. And right across the street is a nice, pleasant little white church.
Okay.
So I guess probably, I'm going to say you probably drove through the night to get there in time. You got there, you probably got a couple of hours sleep in, though, and, you know, you're aware of the big meeting.
Yeah.
Any questions or anything before we jump in? Excellent. So I'm going to read this part. The streets of Bennington are buzzing with the news and gossip about the gunfight last night on the edge of the forest. There's talk of police cars, sirens, shotgun blasts, and escaped kidnappers. The locals are saying that three gangsters were killed. The two police officers were shot. Some say wounded, others say dead. Posters are going up across the town saying that the sheriff is organizing a manhunt to find Lucas Strong's missing daughter and to catch the escaped gangsters. Everyone in town is invited to the meeting at the police station. Rumor has it that Mr. Strong has announced a $5,000 reward for the safe return of his daughter and is willing to pay anyone who can aid in her rescue. So it's now 10 a.m. Everyone is at the police station. Sheriff Jenkins is up in front of everybody. Mr. Strong is in a chair next to him, and he basically is, you know, people, can we get some quiet in here? Calm down here. Yeah. We, I think everybody's pretty much up to speed. There's been a lot of rumors flying around already. I'm here to hopefully quash some of those rumors. And at the same time, Mr. Strong and I both want to thank you all for showing up, for offering your help and trying to bring his daughter back onto him.
We heard that that two police officers were killed. Is that true?
That is true. Two police officers have been taken.
It's not like John Dillinger, is it?
They've been taken or they've been killed?
They've been killed, yeah. Taken from us. We're a small town, so every person that is willing and able to help, we're going to have them out in the woods searching for these guys and to hopefully bring them to justice. Now, I will say this is going to be very dangerous. The woods, as most of you all know, are not a fun place to be. Not only that, but we have reports that there are other people in the woods already. So we have civilians out there. So I don't want you all to be trigger happy and go shooting the first thing you hear or see, because you might be killing an innocent civilian. I will run through a quick little informal deputy process to make it all legal and above board. But if you all do break the law, you all will be held accountable.
Yeah, I've never been in a posse before.
I have a question.
Sure.
You said there was some sort of a ransom thing that went bad. When was the girl kidnapped?
She was taken about 2 or 3 days ago. We've been trying to keep things quiet. Now, some of the rumors have gotten out already. But for the most part, we don't know a whole lot about the kidnappers. Long story short, the exchange was supposed to happen Friday night. We don't know what happened. We don't know who fired first. Depends on who you talk to. But shots were fired and things just went to hell.
Did they take the money with them?
They did.
How much money was it?
See me afterwards. I'm not sure if I want to disclose that publicly at this point.
All right. Do you have a description of the men? Were they all men?
We actually don't know. We assume they are all men. We don't know how many there were. Some people say one. Some people say three. Some people say five. There's a lot of shooting and a lot of confusion and chaos.
Do we know where they entered the woods?
We have a location from Friday night. What we're going to do is, it's now about 10 o'clock, 10:15. We're going to give everyone about 2 hours to go back to your homes, go to Lloyd's shop. We've set up an agreement with Lloyd. He's been kind enough to offer his provisions. Mr. Strong's going to pay for most of everything here. So Lloyd will keep track of a log sheet and, you know, people sign out what they want. If you find that you take it and don't use it, bring it back and exchange it, and you know, everything will be fine.
As long as it's not damaged.
Yes, exactly. Sorry, what was the question? Did I answer your question?
Yes, I just wondered whereabouts they'd gone into the woods.
Right. So the exchange happened just on the edge of town. We're basically sitting at the foot of what's known as the Green Mountain Range. They escaped into the woods. There's basically miles and miles of woods. So it could honestly be anywhere. What we're hoping is that they followed a logging trail, an old logging trail.
Do you have the area taped off or roped off where this exchange happened?
No, this is basically like everybody and anybody in the town is here right now. So it's like...
Oh, okay. No, what I'm saying is, you said that there was an exchange the previous night, sort of a crime scene. Did you tape it off to sort of mark where this happened, giving us a sort of starting point.
We're going to take you all there. We have an officer stationed there right now, just keeping people out of the area.
Okay.
Basically, the edge of town, the old logging road. We're hoping to set you all up as like groups of 4 to 5 people. And hopefully the idea is that you're all going to start marching into the woods and we can sort of form a noose and eventually corral these guys and capture them.
Now, what can you tell me about these guys that we're going after? What is their history?
I'm afraid not much. We have rumors of some names floating around, but at this point, to be honest with you, that's pretty much all they are rumors.
Just rumors? Okay.
Question for the GM.
Mm-hmm.
Us three locals, are there any inherent fears of the woods because of legends or anything that we...
I think that's going to come up shortly, so maybe hold that question, and okay. I think it'll evolve naturally, I think.
Okay.
Good question. Real quick, I think Chester and I talked briefly, Mick and I talked briefly about this. Were you okay with having your character be a hunter?
Yes, ooh. I think he...
Yeah, Chester specifically.
He spends when he's not farming. He spends a fair amount of time out in the woods.
Right. So that's what I wanted. One of you to at least have some hands-on experience with the woods, and you know, maybe not all of you are just walking blindly into a massive
woods. I think it says actually in the long form of his backstory. It says he's a skilled and experienced farmer and backwoodsman who's at home tracking deer as he is behind the wheel of his tractor.
Excellent. Now, the rest of you, do you guys want to also put that in your backgrounds too, or?
I've gone hunting with some of the guys before. It's not really my thing.
Okay.
But I can shoot a gun.
Sure.
No, I can point a shotgun, which is all a storekeeper needs to do. I don't have much time for hunting.
Yep.
I would say that I haven't hunted, but I've, of course, done... investigations that led out into the woods. So I would have a good deal on tracking, and of course I know how to shoot a gun.
Yep. Also, remind me again.
I have medical training as well, so if anyone does get hurt, come and see me.
So Chester, what is this city boy doing here? Why do you think they called him in?
No idea. I think it's just... You know what the local police are like around here. I mean, half the time they just sit around smoking. So,
well, when
they're not, they're not terribly good at anything beyond
the police man,
the police man.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know about bringing in this guy from the outside. What does he know about the woods? We live here.
Yeah, I bet he doesn't know he shouldn't wear red.
Yeah, exactly.
That's for sure.
So one thing about sheriffs is they tend to hear everything. So he will chime in and he's like, yes, some of you have noticed Mr. James Murphy is here. He is from out of town. He is a detective. Remind me real quick, Wayne, you're detective meaning you're actually like with the police force or you're more of a private eye detective?
Yeah, I'm a private investigator, but I was previously with the police.
Right. So everybody, you know, he's going to lend his assistance, and hopefully he has lots of experience with gangsters, bringing people to justice. So
he's very welcome.
Well, that's certainly something we don't have much experience of here in Bennington.
Yeah, you got that right, Chris.
Gee, the last thing our...
Not much crime around these parts. I mean, old man Matthews had that window broken last summer.
Well, but not the worst thing that ever happens here is an occasional brawl.
Yeah. Mm. Jane used to come into my store and get some candy sticks and stuff like that. I'm quite surprised that, yeah, she ends up in being kidnapped here. Mm. Yeah, like this is some sort of big city place.
Mm-hmm.
Well, my pa told me about... there used to be all sorts of fights, and I think even a murder when they had the old the old logging camps, but they're long gone.
Yeah, these parts have always been quiet, and that's how we'd like it.
Now, here's a question. Do we have an idea why the girl was kidnapped?
I'd say money.
Well,
I don't know much about it, just yet.
The thing here is, I'm not, you know, and I'm not trying to be, well, don't take this the wrong way, but I mean, was the individual whose daughter, was he a rich man?
Yes, maybe you wouldn't know specifically, but just standing there looking at him, or possibly when you talked to your cop friends the other night, they might have filled you in with some of these details briefly. So, yes, Mr. Strong is a bigwig of the town. He's on the water department.
How do people in town feel about him? Is he a well-liked man, or...
For the most part, it depends on who you ask. Once people get into a position of being a bigwig in a small town, there's always somebody that kind of like, oh, well, you know how he got there. That's not it.
Well, we're always afraid that he's going to start just buying up the town.
Okay.
It's going to happen. Okay, the truth.
You could certainly tell by looking at him that he's well dressed.
Does he? I'll go up to him. I imagine he's there, right?
He's there. He's sitting in a chair, and he's been fairly quiet for the whole time the sheriff's been talking. You can tell he's looks like he's been through the ringer. You know, he's obviously been crying. He probably didn't get an ounce of sleep at all. So he's looking rough around the edges. During a quick pause from the sheriff, he kind of speaks up, and he's like, I'm offering anyone who's willing and able an additional, just to say thank you, you're all going to be receiving $25 a day.
Wow.
That ain't necessary.
We're going to find your daughter.
We're going to find your daughter.
And I don't care if you bring him back dead or alive. And with that, the sheriff rustles. Now, let's do this.
We're going to make sure that no one like it comes to Bennington again.
Listen,
they're going to think twice about it.
Listen, maybe we'll bring him back to you alive, but we ain't going to bring him back to you like he's going to Sunday. Sunday church.
Al's got it right, eh?
Quite honestly, I'm going to beat the shit out of him.
Yeah. I know what I'd do if it was my daughter, that's for sure.
What is his daughter's name? I'll ask him. Mr. Strong, what is your daughter's name?
Jane?
Yeah.
How old is she, his daughter?
16.
Okay.
She used to always come in the store a few years back on the way back from school and get candy and stuff.
Mm-hmm. 3 years difference, I think you said, between Jane and your daughter, Chester?
That's right. Yeah, my daughter's 13.
So they probably know each other. They might not be friends, but they probably definitely know each other.
Yeah, in a town this size, they'd at least know each other at school.
Yeah.
Mr. Strong, are you married?
Yes, my wife, she's no longer with us.
I see.
Must be awful raising a daughter all by yourself.
Isn't that right?
Mr. Strong, do you have any known enemies?
None that I can think of. I've been thinking about it all night long. Who would do this to me, to us, to Jane?
In the weeks leading up to this, has anyone asked you for money or tried to get you to back some sort of venture or anything?
No, nothing that I can think of.
Actually, a pertinent question that we would all probably know, except for Murphy, is what does Mr. Strong do that he has money?
Yes, that's a good question. He originally got started in the logging industry, so he might actually be somewhat familiar with that logging road. Now, it's a little unclear the way this is written, but it's from the sounds of it, the logging in this area, particular area, it's not really current. So I'm just going to say, for the sake of argument, it's probably been about 5 years since anyone's actually been in there logged this area.
Hmm.
So he started in the logging industry. And then he kind of worked his way up from there. It was he ran his business very well. He made a decent amount of money, and then he basically became a statesman of the town and was brought onto the water board.
Does the company still exist?
No, he's moved on to the, he's basically a full-time politician, sort of.
Do you know if, and this may sound a bit insensitive, but I need to know pretty much all the information I can before I go out. You know if your daughter was involved with a boy in town or...
What the hell kind of a question is that to ask? She's a 16-year-old girl.
Yes, and 16-year-old girls tend to want to have boyfriends.
Maybe in the city.
On these parts.
Okay, old man.
Now, to answer your question directly, not that we are aware of.
I see.
But actually, it's a good question. Has she been hanging around any of the schoolboys?
Right. What is your relationship with your daughter?
Close. I mean, you know, she's my entire world. Everything I do is for her.
I see.
Jeff, as locals, if you were to say to one of the three of us who are locals, the local troublemaker, would there be a name that would immediately come to mind?
Yeah, the sheriff is hesitant to give out names because he doesn't want people to jump to conclusions. He's not entirely sure, but the rumor around town is that it might be Sidney Harris.
Oh, that didn't surprise me.
He's
this is somebody we're all familiar with, and
you've probably met him. He's a jerk. He tends to. He's never done anything like this. You know, maybe he's been hanging out at the pool hall, that sort of thing, or always looking to make a buck.
So tell me more about the Sidney Harris. What makes him sort of a bad sort around?
Yeah, that's what. Like, none of us find this easy to believe. You know, I can't imagine that he would do anything that put the girl's life in jeopardy. But
yeah, it's not going to be a local. It's got to be some people from someplace like Arkham.
Yeah. Could be.
Yeah.
But it's got to be. Right. Got to be somebody who knows that Lucas.
Because somebody's going to drive out here 6 hours from Arkham just to get out here just to kidnap somebody and hang out in the woods.
Well, if you're going to kidnap somebody, officer, you've got to go where they live.
And not only that, but like there are other towns nearby too. So Somerset's not too far down the road.
Mm-hmm. Where did she go missing?
She was kidnapped from the house.
Literally from the house.
Yeah.
Tell me about the moment that you found that she was gone, missing. What happened? Tell me about that particular point of the day or night.
Basically, she went to the store.
What time is this?
Like mid-afternoon. Just sent her for some groceries, just some, you know, some food and stuff. She was due back around 3 o'clock, and I waited and I waited and I waited, and she just never showed up.
Ah, so she got kidnapped on the way to or from the store.
To or from, yeah.
Did the store, well, that would have been Lloyd, right? So did Lloyd see her?
Did I? I don't know. I can't remember seeing that.
So yes, that you sold her a few items.
She came in, bought some food items and everything, put it in a bag for her, and that's the last I saw of her.
Yeah.
She didn't mention going anywhere.
Now, you know, there's a chance like maybe she stopped off somewhere and talked to a friend or something, but I waited and waited, and that's when I called the sheriff in, and then we were contacted with this ransom idea. And it was pretty simple. We were just, you know, we have your daughter. We want money. Show up at Friday night, make the exchange, and hopefully everything went well, but it just ended horribly.
The sound at times. It never used to be like this, did it?
Certainly not in this area.
No, not at all.
You know, I gotta be honest with you. This Murphy, is it?
Yes.
You asked some good questions. I want to be on your team if we're gonna go look for this girl.
Yeah. Standing behind him,
Mr. Lloyd Han, right?
That's right, sir. Yes.
Let me ask you: when Jane came to your shop, your grocery shop.
Mm-hmm.
Did she purchase a lot of material, or did she purchase just one or two things?
I think it was just one or two cans she mentioned that she needed for her supper that evening, officer.
Okay.
And, of course, a little bit of candy, because she always had a sweet tooth.
Well, what was her mood like? I'm sorry, I'm just drilling people, but...
No, you're just doing your job, officer, and that's, yeah. She didn't seem to be out of the... There's nothing to say anything was out of the ordinary that day. I hadn't seen any strangers hanging about or hadn't noticed anything weird in people's moods or anything like that. It was just your average day in Beddington.
Okay.
I wish I could help you more, officer.
That's fine. That's fine.
Hey, Murphy, are you an officer or are you a detective?
Detective.
Do we call you detective or do we call you officer?
That's a good question now.
Since I'm working with you guys, you know, you can call me detective, or if you want to just call me Murphy, that's fine.
Murphy. I think we should call you detective. Yeah, keep that so people know who's in charge.
You're going to call him detective, so I'm going to call Lloyd. I'm going to call you shop owner from now on.
Well, isn't it just like you to do that, Al, isn't it?
We'll call you shoppy.
Well, the man's in charge, isn't it? I mean, otherwise you're just going to end up leaving it, and yeah. God knows where we're going to end up, Connecticut or something.
Sheriff, is Detective Murphy in charge, or are you in charge?
Of the overall investigation, I'm in charge of everything. Everybody, if you have questions, come see me.
Murphy, you're okay. I'm just giving you a hard time.
I understand.
It's your red hair.
Irish.
Always. Yes.
Yeah. So what we can do is we can basically end the public announcement, right. I guess you would call this. Did I already say? So basically what we're going to do is you're all going to have 2 hours.
Right.
At noon, we're going to meet out at the field.
Yep.
And then we'll get a start from there.
Yep. So take
these 2 hours, gather supplies.
Mm-hmm.
Pick up whatever you think you might need for this. Could take, I mean, we hope that it's going to end soon, but what we would like to do is to have everybody plan on at least 4 to 5 days out in the woods.
I'll make sure we're going to have supplies and everything like that.
Right. And possibly, so if you go 4 days into the woods, it's going to take you 4 days to get out of the woods.
So before we leave, you said that privately you disclose the amount.
Right. So that's everyone's going to kind of break apart. The sheriff's going to assign you all into the alpha team. So you guys, with James's background, he wants you guys to take point on everything. Yes. The question was about the ransom.
Yeah.
Please don't get everyone hyped about this, but the amount was $10,000.
That's a whole heap of dough.
And are you saying this just to the sheriff, or are you saying this to Mr. Strong too?
Just to the sheriff.
Okay. So probably, I think I forgot to mention this, which is a really important fact. Mr. Strong is offering a $5,000 reward.
Wow. Yeah.
So, okay. And just so everybody at home knows, the rough, it's actually like more like 12 to 14%, but just for math reasons, if you just multiply everything by 10, so 5,000 would be $50,000.
Yeah. Yeah. In equivalent of today's money.
You're right.
You know, one thing I missed along the way is, what's the sheriff's name?
I believe it was Jenkins. Yes, yeah. Sheriff Jenkins.
Sheriff Jenkins.
Hmm. Oh dear, sorry.
Is it first name?
Leroy.
That'll work. Well,
I was kind of hoping it wasn't Brown.
Mr. Ratface.
Leroy? Leroy Jenkins.
That's fine.
Okay. Oh, hang on. Sorry. I accidentally wrote down Sharif Jenkins.
Sharif.
He's a Moroccan gentleman.
Well,
Sharif can lock it.
Lloyd.
Very good at bridge.
You know, I think it's about time. You don't have to supply me with anything. Do you still have that that shotgun that I've been looking at? The fancy, I don't know, Winchester?
You know damn well I have, Al. You come along to my store and I'll be able to help out.
I was going to buy that around Christmas time, but you know what? I think I'll just go ahead and buy it right now.
Well, you take it and you pay me at Christmas then.
No, I got some money stashed away.
Yeah. What have you been doing?
Mechanicking.
Mechanicking.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll head back to my store. We get supply. How many days supplies do you reckon we should get? I mean, 8 days for us. This could be a lot of food.
Yeah, we're not going to worry too much about, you know, the mechanics of this. You know, 8 days, you guys are going to be burdened down with a ton of stuff. So we won't get too far into the details of it. But I would like everybody to just kind of give me kind of the basics, and we won't have to worry about.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm gonna go home and I'll pick up my old knapsack that I take out hunting with me. There's a few bits and pieces in it already.
Mm-hmm.
While I'm back at home, I'm just I've got an old shotgun at home that I just use for just dealing with vermin, anything that might be crawling about.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just gonna get that out and whatever shells I can find for it, and leave that with my wife, because I'm not really, you know, there are people wandering around abducting people from their houses. I just want to make sure that everything's okay back at home, and then I'll take my rifle with me.
Okay.
And I think I'll if we're picking up stuff from the store, I might actually buy a I mean, I've got a few shells for the rifle, but I think I might buy a box of shells. I mean, if they're saying that there might be shooting involved.
Don't forget sleeping bags as well.
I'll take my bedding roll with me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, let's finish up the weapons first. So let me go back to Al first. Do you need stats on anything?
Well, I was just writing it down. Can it be a 12-gauge shotgun, double barrel? Yeah.
Whatever you want, whatever makes sense.
I'm writing it all down, so.
No Tommy guns.
And that's going to cost me, let's say that cost me about $150.
Now, don't forget, he's offering you $25 a day. So
that can also. But $150 is a hell of a lot of money. But I've been saving up because I want that gun.
Mm-hmm.
I could say, pay me in installments so it makes it easy for you. Al, you ain't going to go anyway.
So, Al, what was it? Shotgun?
Yeah, double barrel shotgun. Damage is 4d6, 2d6, and 1d6. Range is 10, 20, and 50 yards. I can do one or two shots per round, and it malfunctions on a 100. Costs about $150.
Double barrel. Would that be considered pellet, or would that be slugs?
I have no idea. I know nothing about guns. Just a shotgun,
so if you are hunting, I don't think it matters actually the gun specifically, but basically, like, if you're out deer hunting, you would use slugs. If you're out bird hunting, you would use pellets.
Or rock salt, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
So basically, it's like what level of lethalness do you want?
You know what? I like the sound of the rock salt, because that'll stop somebody, but it won't kill them.
Yeah. I mean, we are trying to take them alive after all.
Right. And it'll hurt like hell.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm going to use rock salt.
Okay. Rock salt only? Or do you want to take it?
No, I'm going to bring some shot, because maybe we'll shoot some rabbits along the way to add a little protein to our diet.
Absolutely. That's a really good idea. You don't necessarily have to pack in everything.
Right.
Especially in this time of the year, or this time of 1925, yeah. There are creeks and things out there, and it's perfectly safe to drink the water out there. So.
Okay.
Lloyd, you said you were bringing a rifle?
No, I'm a 20-gauge shotgun. Okay. That's the only firearm I have.
Same question. Do you want slugs, pellets, rock salt?
Majority rock salt, but I'll have about 4 or 5 decent ammo ones just in case because of bears and stuff like that.
Sure.
But rock salt should be enough to floor anything.
Okay. Chester, you wanted the rifle.
Yeah, I'm carrying a 30-06 bolt action rifle.
Ooh. Wow.
My deer hunting rifle.
He knows what you're doing there, Chester.
And Mr. Murphy?
Yeah, I mean, I've already got my revolver, but since everybody else is sort of loading up with rifles and shotguns, I'm going to go with a 30 caliber bolt action Winchester. And that should be about between 75 and 175.
75, you get it at a discount, as it's to do with it. Mm-hmm. I don't want to make profit out of it.
I have something additional, but go ahead.
Does anybody know with the bolt action, do you still, that's a single load, right? You have to load it.
It's got a clip of 5, but you
about
have
five,
to.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Have to well, you, but you have to sort of eject the car. Yeah. And then.
Yeah.
Right.
Chester, your rifle, is there an amount of bullets or mags?
The clip is 5 rounds. And the base range is 110 yards.
20 gauge shotgun, would that be a single shot, right?
It's double barreled, so I can shoot 1 or 2.
Gotcha.
The damage is 2d6, 1d6, 1d3, 10, 20, 50 range.
Okay, that's the important thing as far as weapons, unless anybody wants anything else.
I have one additional.
Mm-hmm.
I mentioned in my my character sheet that I have a big monkey wrench at the shop called Betty Lou. but I also have a little one called Little Betty. And that's always in my back pocket.
Gotcha.
So we'll give that a 1d8. It's the same as a black check, more or less. Mm-hmm. If I smash somebody across the face with it or hit them.
I'm actually going to also pick up a hunting knife.
Okay.
That actually seems like a utility thing, so I bet you I have one of those too.
Yeah, I'll get a knife as well.
I've got a decent sized pen knife. It's just the same one I always carry, but when I'm on the farm. So it's the one I know.
Yeah, wanted to be a pen knife as well.
Call it a medium.
A lighter. Maybe a lighter as well.
1d4 plus 2. Okay, for a knife.
Would one of you... So the woods, you would all know this from living in the area. The woods are a mix of some of it's light, some of it's like kind of an open field feel to it.
Mm-hmm.
Some of it is actually heavy woods, you know, briars, something that would impede your process. For the most part, it's easily walkable. But you might want to take something like possibly a machete or an axe to trailblaze if you need it.
Like a hand axe?
Yeah.
Might be good to take a couple of hatchets along because we, you know, in case we've got to break up some wood for fires as well.
I should imagine Chester would be the one to think of that anyway because he's more of a woodsman than we are.
Right.
So what maybe we could do is maybe instead of taking one of the knives, maybe one of you could take an axe or hatchet.
Yeah, I'll take a little like a woodsman's hatchet. You know, one of the ones with an axe on one side and a pry bar on the back, that kind of thing.
Yep. I'll pick up some flint and steel as well.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll go zip a lot.
And for light, do we have flashlights? Or
yeah, I'm sorry. I meant to say that. I have flashlights down here as well.
Do we maybe have a lantern?
Okay, so I actually did a little research on this. Back in 1925, the average flashlight would last 2 to 4 hours. So what I would recommend is possibly, either all of you could take a flashlight or some of you could take a flashlight. But I would recommend some sort of a lantern or something like that.
Yeah, maybe if we take a carbide lamp and then we can just, because you can keep one of those going for ages with a drop more water in it.
Yeah, and we can carry spare batteries as well.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I'll get a carbide lamp and little tin of carbide from Lloyd.
My guess is that as far as spare batteries go, it's probably a dry cell. And they're probably about that big around the battery for the flashlight.
Mm.
So those are heavy.
Do we have one inch back in this back in this time? Would they have had like steel wool?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm, probably.
All right, I'll pick up a handful of that too, because that can help start a fire with a battery.
Yep. Sorry, Mick. What is a carbide lamp?
It's like a they were originally miners' lamps, but by this time they'd also be the first bicycle lamps as well. So it's like a basically you put calcium carbide in the bottom of it, which you just buy in the general store, and then you just you'd have a little thing full of water on top of it, and the lever on the top controls the dripping, so it drips water into the calcium carbide. And that makes acetylene gas, which it then burns out the front. And it produces quite a bright light. It lasts for quite a while. And a little tin of carbide would last, for a couple of weeks.
Okay. Great.
So as long as it's one of the ones with a glass front so it doesn't get blown out.
Mm-hmm. All right. I want to ask you, how do you want to treat the sleeping arrangements? Do you want like one large tent? Do you want small individual tents?
One large tent?
Yeah, let's say one large tent. Does that sound good?
Oh, I've spent half my life in the wood. I'm happy to just sleep by the fire.
I should imagine it's going to be supplied by the government or something like that. So it would be a large one, wouldn't it?
What's the temperature like right now?
During the days, it can actually get hot, especially like if you guys are out hiking and carrying stuff. But during the nights, it's chilly enough that you might probably want to have a fire.
Yeah. Quite dry, though.
No, what I was going to say is maybe we could just bring blankets rolled up and just sleep near the fire instead of putting up a tent.
I was thinking of, I have a sleeping bag down here, so.
Yeah.
Just have a tent.
I do know.
Tents are heavy.
Yeah, tents are heavy.
They didn't have nice little nylon things. These are oilcloth, big, heavy oilcloth tents.
And just to let you know, like even in the summertime, if you're out in the woods like this, it could get rather cool.
Yeah.
At night, so it can be frosty, even in the summer. So it's good to have something. But blankets and sleeping bags are good enough.
If the weather turns, we could always make just a free shelter or something.
Take a tarpaulin with us. We can always put the tarpaulin up as a makeshift center down, shelter down.
Okay. Chester, give me an idea roll.
Yes.
You would know from your previous experience out hunting in these woods that occasionally throughout the woods there are small hunting shacks.
Oh, right. Okay.
So if worse comes to worse, you might be able to, it might be hard to find, but you might be able to locate one based off of memory or just luck stumbling upon it.
Okay.
Now, in the Vermont woods, what's the largest predator that we might run across? Are they a bear?
Yep.
Okay.
Black bear, brown bear, grizzly.
Grizzly.
Black.
Yep.
Yeah, I don't know that they'd have grizzly. This.
Yeah, that's more out west.
That's northern. Yeah. Okay. And then there's probably other things like badgers and nasty little things like that. But yeah, they're pretty much scared of us. So.
All right. Might run into the odd skunk here and there, maybe.
Nah, skunks are harmless. Just don't kick one. Don't run up to a skunk and go, ah!
Actually, skunks are they don't see well at all.
Right.
And usually when people get sprayed, it's because they got scared because you snuck up on them. So the reverse is true. When you see a skunk, you want to make a lot of noise so that they know you're coming.
Yeah.
It's the same with bears, isn't it?
Or
you should always be saying, hello, bear.
I have some skunk stories, but I'll tell them after the show.
Yeah. All right. So, one thing I'm trying
to. So, is there anything else that we need that we're not thinking of?
Compass.
We can always bring matches.
I've got a compass. Yeah, I've got a compass already.
Yeah, excellent. We got matches. We got compass. We got fresh water, water skins.
Got food. Got tarpaulin. Got sleeping bags.
Plenty of coffee. We need to be brewing up coffee.
Yeah, coffee.
We got our plus three dagger.
Everybody give me an idea roll.
Yes.
Yes.
I made that on the hard as well.
I did not.
I did not.
Think about when you come upon the kidnappers.
I was just thinking.
How are you going to get them back to town?
Yeah, tie them up. We need some rope.
Oh yeah, because I've got some twine, but that's going to be no good for something like that.
How many handcuffs has the detective got?
Probably one pair. Or
do we even know how many? Really, know how many of them there are? I mean, they could even have more people out there than.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah. The rough.
So I think ropes are a good idea.
I'll ask Sheriff Jenkins if he has any spare handcuffs as well.
Yeah, handcuffs would be better, but we could take the rope just in case.
So he'll say, since basically everybody's asking for handcuffs, he'll give each team their own set of handcuffs. So let's see, Murphy, you would probably have a set on you already.
Yeah.
And then, so this will give you two sets of handcuffs.
Who's going to carry the handcuffs?
He's also going to give every team a whistle. So that should you find either the daughter or the kidnappers, and hopefully the next team or posse is within close enough distance that if you blow on a whistle long enough, somebody should also come helping.
Okay.
We could take a flare gun for an emergency.
No.
No, not in the woods.
We'd start a fire.
Huge fire.
Just look for the place where the
flush them out.
That's where
we take it.
I'll definitely have a coil of rope from Lloyd's that's light enough to where it's not too heavy, but at the same time, it's strong enough that you couldn't break it with your bare
hands. Yep. If I was thinking ahead of time, I would have looked up when duct tape was invented. But
yeah, probably not for quite a while.
Let's see. Give me one more idea roll, and then I'm sure some of you.
Yep.
Well, I made that one.
Okay, so maybe from going into the woods before going on hunting trips, you might have some sort of system already worked out where is there something that you would want to do to prevent yourself from being lost? Now, I can give you two recommendations or suggestions. One would be something as simple as using your knife or your axe and just shaving off some of the tree as you travel. Another idea would be to use like some ribbon something bright that would show up.
From a they wouldn't have any sort of spray paint back then, would they?
No, probably not. No.
And by the way, duct tape was invented in the 1920s.
Hmm. Oh, it's just going to fall a chest up.
But it says it was first created and manufactured in 1942. So, by Johnson and Johnson. So
you couldn't buy it.
No. I think I'd favor just, you know, breaking a branch, leaving a pile of rocks.
Okay.
You know, traditional old woods craft rather than buying a
rock. Knives. So if we need to, we can mark a tree.
Yeah. Or, you know, the cloth thing or ribbon thing isn't a bad idea. Cloth isn't very heavy. Tear off a piece or something like that. Hang it on a branch.
Yeah, maybe. I mean, you know, those of you who aren't as comfortable in the woods might
want to
do that.
If you want to add that to yours, Murphy, that's fine.
Well, Mr. Murphy, that's an interesting idea, but we got birds around here called blackbirds that they see something shiny or something colorful and they take it back to their nest. So they could probably untie your ribbon and just fly off with it.
Well,
but remember the story of Hansel and Gretel leaving the crumbs along the path and the birds ate them all.
Yeah.
They can't eat a notch in a tree.
That's why I'll have something like a dark colored piece of cloth or something.
I'll keep an eye on my compass from time to time as well, you know, just to...
So as you guys are doing all this, Lloyd's store is packed. You know, he's running around trying to wait on everybody. Everybody's pretty much trying to scramble and get what they think is important. There's also time for a lot of rumors start flying now.
Okay.
Chester... You are familiar with Shirley Jackson. She's the local librarian. She starts asking you what you think about. Are you concerned at all about the ghosts and the hauntings out there?
Well, I mean, I've always taken those stories with a pinch of salt. You know, my father told me a few stories, and my grandfather told me a lot of stories. But you know, my grandfather, he was mainly used to tell me the old Indian stories. Like there was some old tale about a big hairy man that lived out there. I mean, Pa said that he saw some people once. I don't know, it would have been about the 70s or 80s. There was some story about a stagecoach getting turned over by a big hairy man out there in the woods, but... I don't know. It doesn't sound. There's all sorts of stories, pukwudgies, Indian stories. You know,
I don't know.
There's a tale. There's a tale about a man eating boulder. That the Indians had a story about that. But the only thing I can think of is that when I was at school, some boys at school said they'd heard the whistle of the old train along the train line. Where there's no train running, but no, I don't know. Dad said there was a wild man lived in a cave up there. I don't think that was a legend. I think that was just an old guy living in a cave. They waved a revolver at some people and they ran him out of town. But I don't know. I think it's stories more than anything else.
I tend to get the sense that as an individual story, you know, just somebody looking to brag or talk, but it seems like a lot of people have similar stories coming out of there, so makes me think there might be something to it.
It's an odd place. I mean, there used to be a whole town up there once, up in the woods, but just didn't work out.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of people got killed, and they tried to turn it into a tourist resort. I know my mom and pa took me up there for a trout supper once, up on the tram, but then I think it was back in 98, the floods came and just washed the train line away. There was a landslide, and that was the last of it. It's only like a handful of people living up there now. Mm-hmm. Couldn't even tell you their names. Don't know any of them. But it's a funny place up there. I mean, some folks say that wild man came back and lived and started eating people up there. But I think that was just like,
oh my, I hadn't heard that.
I think they just, to be honest, like, we were just kids at the time. I think they just told us that tale to stop us going up in the woods.
I heard it was a man with a hook.
I think they just didn't want us going up there shooting squirrels.
Are you telling those crazy stories about the wild man of the woods?
I'm just, she asked, I'm just telling her what my grandpa told me. My grandpa had all sorts of stories about Glastonbury Mountain.
Murphy, you're hearing this. Yeah. Give me an idea. Are you buying any of this, or are you, how's your character reacting to any of this?
I failed on the idea role, but, I you know, at Miskatonic, I did take up, some, you know, courses on the occult. So my ears are sort of perked up listening to all this.
Okay.
So I'll ask her, well, what sort of stories are you guys talking about within the woods?
So, I mean, everything that Chester's talked about, and I'm sure, actually, same question to Al and Lloyd. What are your characters? Do they believe these? Are they hogwash?
Oh, Murphy. Murphy, you should know that these woods are full of really strange things that are out there looking for city boys who are going to come out there in the woods and not know what the hell they're doing.
Mm. Back in Indian days, the Mohicans wouldn't go up there. They called it a forbidden place.
Yeah.
They said the land was sour.
I'm just a God-fearing man.
Well, my grand used to try to scare me with fairy tales when I was younger.
Oh, there ain't no fairies out there, no.
Well,
thank God there isn't.
Big hairy, yeah, what? Bug
leprechauns.
Big hairy monster men. Yeah. They push trains into the river.
I don't think people take much notice.
While we're out there. We ought to show Murphy how to hunt for snipe.
Ah, it's in season.
Yeah, it's in season.
I'll bring me bait.
But you know what? To be honest, about the weirdest thing I ever heard was during one of the floods that they some really odd things washed down river that people couldn't quite explain what they'd seen.
Yeah, I think my granddad said something about bits of lobster or something.
Yeah, some sort of crustacean.
My brother talked about he went hunting out there once, and he came back pretty quick after going out there. He said that he thought he saw somebody just staring at him in the woods. Just nothing aggressive about it, but that's what made it creepy.
Look, Murphy, and I put my hand on his shoulder. There are some strange animals out there that make some very strange noises. So when it sounds like something's whispering in your ear, probably just a damn bird.
Okay.
Or Lloyd.
And when those deer are mating as well, oh, there's some noises for you.
That sounds like screaming. That's very strange sound.
Yeah, I've heard male deer rutting. It sounds like the door of hell opening.
Give me an idea, Rochester. Or Al, both of you.
Okay.
No, I failed that one.
Ooh, I got a 15.
You are aware of this. It actually is hunting season.
Okay.
All right, so unless there's any other supplies you guys want to talk about?
No, I'm just getting small.
No, I think we've got everything we need.
Okay. We'll say there's still a little bit of time if there's anything that anybody wants to do before you go to the
while everybody is sort of inside of Lloyd's place, I'm going to look on the outside of Lloyd's place. Would I have gotten an idea of like the town, how it's set up, the mapping of the town where Mr. Strong would live in comparison to the shop,
to Lloyd's shop?
Yeah.
He's kind of, you know, He's kind of on the edge of town, maybe.
To the north or south of town? Or east or west, whichever way it's
going.
Would
be, I'm trying to think. It would be to the east, probably.
Okay. All right, so what I'm going to do is just look around to see if... and I'll walk a little bit down this road to see if maybe she got snatched up off the street and dropped her cans or whatever produce that she would have had, or any sort of clues to see if she was either snatched up or abducted against her will, or if she actually went along with it.
Give me a spot hidden.
Sure. And that's a pass.
You don't find anything like that.
Trying to think. Okay.
Yeah, that's...
Okay.
Yep.
All right. If there's anybody walking around, like maybe somebody standing outside their house or in another shop or whatever, and they're just out on the front porch of it,
mm-hmm.
I'll go up and I'll ask them if they had seen anything the previous day.
They tell you they didn't notice anything. They don't even, you know, they might remember seeing Jane walk by, but it was like, it's a common occurrence, so they didn't even really take
that. So you didn't hear anything like any sort of screaming or any sort of car rolling up and screeching to a halt or anything like that?
No, nothing was heard.
Nothing out of the ordinary.
Right.
Okay. I'll thank them for their time. And mm-hmm. Yeah. All right.
Give me a spot. That's not really a spot. Give me an idea, bro.
Okay. I make it.
When you're out kind of wandering and checking these things out, you see... in the town, there's a little tiny, like the Bennington Press.
Okay. I'll check it out.
There's a gentleman there. His name is Frank. He's busy typing away, making notes. This is the most excitement the town's seen in a really long time. And he's like, yes, can I help you?
Yes. And I'll introduce myself. My name is James Murphy. I'm here to help with the investigation of the abduction of Jane Strong.
Yeah. It's a horrible thing.
Yeah. Question. On the day that she was abducted, did you see or hear anything strange? And I'm pretty sure that the sheriff would have come and talked to everybody here, but did you notice her walking by your business?
I've been racking my brain. I'm trying to think. As far as I can remember, nothing unusual about it at all.
Did you notice her walking towards Lloyd's store during any time that day? Should have been like mid-afternoon. Well,
I think I saw her. But again, I mean, I've seen her 100 times, so I can't remember if that was the day before or yesterday. Or...
Okay. Let me ask you this. Did you hear any sort of commotion or anything that would have gotten you up from your desk? Maybe some yelling or... arguing or anything like that that might have lifted your head from your typing?
I'm afraid not. And you would know at this point from dealing with the sheriff that if he had any leads like that, he probably mm-hmm. would have either followed up on it himself or okay. would have filled you guys in like as, you know, hey, check this out.
Okay. I'm good. Well, yeah. I was also going to look for anything that she might have dropped, like, you know, hair ribbon or her purse or something like that. Just
yep.
something that might have been maybe, you know, I'm trying to imagine. Is this is the road sort of like a dirt road, or is it like paved?
Pretty much a dirt road. Yeah.
Yeah. So you know, I'm like kind of looking through the dirt road dust or whatever to see if there's anything lying on the ground like that.
Mm-hmm.
Just trying to look for any sort of signs of struggle.
Mm-hmm. Trying to think. So like without actually walking the entire route, you probably don't see anything. And even like, you know, who's to say a scuffle would be just some kids playing in the dirt, that sort of thing.
True, so true.
Nothing really jumps out at you.
Okay.
Give me a library.
A what? Library?
Library roll.
Okay. Nope.
Okay. Frank will strike up a conversation, and he can tell that you're from out of town.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, did you get any information? I noticed you guys were talking to the sheriff afterwards about why the kidnappers took the daughter.
No, there was no. All we know is there was a ransom note. We believe it's about money, but do you have any ideas? Do you have a sort of a theory?
I'm nervous, and I pray that I didn't have anything to do with it. A couple weeks back, I published a story about how Mr. Strong's looking to build a reservoir out in those woods. And it was reported, leaked to me, that they might have found some precious metals out there. And Mr. Strong has a survey team out there right now, investigating that, looking into that claim. And I published that. And I just can't help to think that maybe somebody read that and they thought that maybe Mr. Strong had found a bunch of gold or something.
Hmm. Do you have a copy of that article?
Yeah, he'll hand it to you.
Okay.
I don't have it.
Okay. Is anybody in this town, and I mean, this is basically between us, but would there be anybody in this town that would seem out of place? Not like an outsider, but like someone that seems kind of shady or shifty. Some character that you personally don't like.
You mean Al?
What's wrong with Al?
No.
What's wrong with Al?
No. I think he tried to stiff me once in trying to fix my car, but I don't know anything about cars, so I don't have anything to prove that. But.
I see. But nobody, no youngsters that are sort of.
I mean, it's a small town like any other small town. You know, like pretty much everybody knows everybody's business here, so there's not a whole lot of opportunity for, you know, kids will pull pranks, kids will get in trouble, but you know.
What about the Sydney Harris character?
Yeah, he's people are bringing up his name as a possibility. He's a little down on his luck, it seems, lately. I really don't think he's a violent person. I can't imagine him doing this.
So you said that he's sort of down on his luck. What do you mean by that?
Just like money-wise, I think he's having a hard time financially. So that's what I've put together in my head, that if he read one of my articles and thinks there's gold out there, then I hope he just didn't do something stupid.
I see. How old is Sydney?
He might even be, just gullible. So maybe he was talking to some of his buddies and then they came up with the idea and talked him into it. So I don't know.
Well, are these buddies of his in town? Or are they sort of, is there
no, like, yeah, I think they're from the next town over.
Let me see. Do you know, well, how old is Sydney?
I think he's in his late 20s. actually have that written down, so we'll just say it's late 20s.
Okay. Would you have noticed at any point in time if he was interested in Jane? Have you ever seen those two talking and maybe he's trying to become maybe an item with Jane?
Oh, I see what you're saying. I seriously don't think that would happen. I mean, it might, but I don't. I think the age difference is pretty much.
Yeah, true. But
I've never seen any evidence of that.
Okay.
Can I ask a question outside since I'm not there?
Sure.
Who is it that that Murphy is talking to?
The local reporter, basically.
Do you have a name?
Frank.
Important?
Frank.
Frank. Yeah.
Do you have a last name?
Frank Coates. No relation.
No relation. He spells it without the E at the end.
Exactly.
And was it the Bennington Post?
Yeah, the Bennington Press.
Press or Post?
Was it Press or Post?
If you want to get specific, it's Bennington Banner.
Oh, okay. Bennington Banner. We would all know that. So, that's just for the record. I just don't know. I don't know any of the conversation that you've had.
Okay.
For my notes.
All right. Is there anything else that might come to mind that you might want to share with me?
Give me either a luck roll or a library.
I'm going to say luck because it's a little higher. And no, that still doesn't get me anything. So
I will say, too, I do like playing where we can spend luck points. So I'll put a max of 8 points for if you guys aren't familiar with that. Basically, if you miss a roll by 8 points, you can spend luck points to make your roll. But those points are taken off and they don't come back.
Yeah, I think I'm going to need my luck points later on. So,
okay.
It's actually one of the reasons why I've removed the luck points from the
game. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Because they change.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, especially if I have to do a dex roll.
Which I thought would be funny. At the very first one, I told you were staying at the Wallumsack Inn. I was going to have you come down the stairs and do a dex roll. But anyway. Inside joke. Yeah, so I think you've pretty much gotten what you need to know out of him.
Okay. All right. Well, once I'm done with this, and I'll head back to Lloyd's and see when these guys are ready, and we can head out.
Yep. Yep, go ahead.
For the record, Wayne, you can always spend skill points to add to your dexterity. You are so inclined.
Yeah.
When you're rolling up that. You're rolling up your character.
Okay.
It's listed as a skill.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Let's see. Okay, yeah. Unless anybody has anything else, we can move forward.
Cool. I'm ready.
Yeah.
Let's look at these. Okay.
So, it's around noon. Everybody's buzzing around town. There's a certain amount of excitement mixed in with the, you know, everybody's upset, obviously. But there's a mixture of, you know, let's go get these guys.
Yeah.
Let's find the girl. So, emotions are running high. But everybody's anxious to get started. So you meet at the area where the shootout happened on Friday night.
Right.
It's a clearing on the side of the road. This is on the edge of town. The actual clearing was logged a long time ago, so there's a lot of like knee-high stumps scattered here and there. Maybe I'm going to say roughly 100 yards, say, from the road is where the woods pick up. There is that logging trail I mentioned. It's heading roughly northeast.
Okay. Now, where's I'll ask. Where's this gorge where they found the minerals? Where his company found the minerals? Is that along the side of the logging path, or is that going away?
Okay. Who would you be asking that?
I'll ask. I guess that these gentlemen would read the paper. And I have the papers with me too, but I'll ask them. Would you guys know anything about this type of this area?
They do not. The mention of the precious metals is new to them too. I mean, there might have been rumors of gold at some point, but nobody's ever done anything.
And the paper doesn't say, "Oh, it was found here,"
right?
Specifically,
right.
Okay,
right.
Okay. I will say that my character will have this sort of bigger sort of notebook that he pulls out, leather-bound notebook that he pulls out, and he starts writing down clues and everything like that in this book.
Yep.
Sort of like a tax man.
Just the facts man.
Yeah.
All the different posses are around. The sheriff is showing you where the shootout happened. It's a little bit of a grisly scene. There's blood from, where the officers got shot. The town's dealing with that in their own way. Right now, there's the town's kind of split. You have certain, like, a lot of the people are taking care of that, and the rest of you are like, let's get these guys.
So do we know that they drove off along the logging trail?
There was no sight or sound of a vehicle.
So they ran.
Oh, right. Okay.
I do want to take a look around of the scene. Are there any sort of spent shell casings?
Absolutely. It looks like a shootout definitely happened here.
Okay. What type of casings are they?
Much what the local PD would have had. So I would assume shotguns, rifles.
What about return fire from the...
Yeah, so the sheriff gets everybody set up, spreads everybody out, there's quite a bit of distance between each posse. You guys, like he said, is kind of the alpha team. So he's going to put you where the kidnappers were last supposedly seen. And by seen, I mean basically gunshots, like muzzle flash, that sort of thing.
Okay.
So he takes you to where the woods start, and it actually is at the logging road. And everybody can give me a spot hidden.
Ooh. Oh, critical.
I missed that by three, but I will use three luck points.
Definitely got a critical.
I found a big pile of bear crap.
Well, the fact that he got an 07, you can keep your luck points. I don't think you'll need to spend it.
Okay.
So, Lloyd, you see some splatterings of blood.
I should point it out to the others.
Look. Yep. The sheriff will say, one of our officers said they think they winged him or hit somebody, but obviously didn't do a whole lot of damage.
Well, where's the blood splatter at? Is it against a tree or something?
Mm-hmm.
I'll take a look at the tree to see if the bullet, if there's a bullet in there.
It looks like it might have been the shotgun shell, the pellets.
Pellets? Okay.
Could I
see if we could follow along the blood trail? There's,
yeah, I was going to say, could I try a track roll to see if I can find
at least general.
Any more evidence of this blood?
Sure, absolutely. Signs or something they call.
I'll give it a go as well. And no, hell's bells.
Oh man,
you found the bear shit today.
Yeah, I did. I actually stepped in it.
I told you it was right there.
Mine was successful.
Okay, so about I don't know, 30 yards maybe, not that far. You see another little speck or splattering drop.
Is the sheriff with us still, or did he leave?
He's at the.
He basically showed us.
He showed you where to start. And he's basically saying, you know, you've already found the track and you're all ready to go. So unless you have questions.
Yeah, I have one more question. I know there isn't really an autopsy done with these guys yet, but do we know what type of caliber bullet was used or was found inside the officers? That's why I was looking for the shell casings with the return fire.
So you see... You would probably see a 30-06 shell casing as well as a shotgun shell casing.
Okay. So I'll let you guys know about that, and this is what we're going to be going up against. As long as it wasn't a, sort of .45 caliber Thompson round.
No elephant gun, nothing like that.
Okay. Nothing automatic.
No.
All right. Okay. All right, so let's head down this road and follow the blood splatters.
Okay. Tell me briefly how you guys would like to do this. Go ahead.
I think we should be quite sort of quiet and discreet, because these are dense woods, and it would be very easy for us to be ambushed out here.
Yeah,
I think too. We
if
should.
If someone heard us coming, we could get into a whole heap of trouble.
Hmm. Now let me ask you. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I was just gonna say, I think we should also not follow one right after the other, because we might miss a clue. Maybe if we walk a few, 3 or 4 feet away from each other in a line, so that we're covering if we find any more blood, if we find anything.
All right. Let me ask you.
I mean, we're a search party after all, aren't we? We should behave like one.
GM, let me ask you this. The blood splatter, was it high on the tree or was it lower on the tree?
Yeah, lower. No, you don't need to do that. I'm sorry. We'll say high up on the tree.
Okay. So he just probably got winged in the arm or shoulder or something. Okay. So that won't really slow him down. Okay.
Well, if he's losing blood and he's out here in the woods.
Well, that will slow him down, but it's not that it was a late shot.
It'll be a while, but he'll start to run a risk of infection after a while out here.
I guess a more pointed question is the amount of blood. Does it look like he was winged through his muscle? You know, there's a large amount of blood and he's bleeding everywhere, or did he just get winged and now he's probably just wrapped it with a piece of cloth and he's not going to bleed?
Right. Yeah, that's a good question. I'm not going to make you roll, because it's kind of, you would probably know this from your experience of hunting also. So we'll say it's to the, I mean, it's hard to tell specifically, but we'll say that it's substantial. It's not like maybe life-threatening, like a huge pool, but it's enough that you guys saw it and are able to see that it's continuing. So it's like a steady flow, I guess, is what.
So even if he wrapped it with cloth, it would get saturated fairly quickly and still continue to drip occasionally.
Probably, yes.
All right.
Cool. All right. I know this is, it's probably not even in the module, but the question is, when we're tracking the blood splatter, is it sort of in a wavery line, or is it kind of like going straight? I'm trying to imagine, you know, them running through the woods. Is it sort of like they stay on a path, or is it kind of like they're going off the path?
So before I answer that, what is everybody wearing?
I've got something that's that'd be comfortable for a trek in the woods.
I've got like my pajamas and pajamas.
So I told you that Al guy is a little.
What do you call them? You know, they're underwear that go all the way down.
Long johns.
Yeah, and I've got my blue and green plaid, warm shirt on, and I've got stuff. I've got layers so that if it gets cold, if it gets hot, I can take them off.
What color long johns?
And boots.
What color long johns?
Blue. They're baby blue. They're this color blue.
Never wear red.
Yeah. Lloyd, what are you wearing?
Don't wear red.
I've got a coveralls, or dungarees as we call them in England. Thick shirt and boots, maybe a bow tie.
What color shirt?
Black and white.
Chester?
I'm wearing a grass skirt and a boob tube. No. I'm wearing a denim bib and brace overalls, sort of blue and white hickory striped shirt, and work boots. And I've got a brown plaid hunting jacket and a trapper's hat in my knapsack for when it gets cold at night.
We're not doing the community version of South Pacific until next month.
And Murphy?
A pair of trousers. I'll say they're, or like denim trousers or something like that. Mm-hmm. Flannel shirt, red and black type of a flannel shirt, and an undershirt underneath there. And boots, hiking boots.
Yep. That's fine. Is anybody else wearing a hat?
Yeah.
We have a hat on as well.
Okay. Whatever the popular hat is this time of for us.
Fez?
Not a fez. Not a baseball cap. Very likely. It's probably like
wearing this fez. I'm wearing a fez.
Just about everybody wears a fedora, don't they? Are you wearing a fez?
Yeah, it has some strange writing that means it. I just can't get it off.
It's also bright red.
Yeah. No, I'm wearing, I'll wear a basic hat, like a, I don't know if they had like a baseball type cap or something like that back then, but something like that.
Mm-hmm.
To hide the red hair.
In the 20s, my guess is that everybody wore like fedoras.
Everyone definitely wore hats, didn't they?
Yeah, pretty much. Okay, I know that seems mundane for me to even ask, but there might be a reason, it might not. Okay, so as you're heading off into the woods now, the trail, like you were saying, does pretty much start to follow the road. After about maybe 30 minutes to an hour of hiking, you see the trail head off into the woods.
Okay.
Would you say at 30 minutes we're about 2 miles maybe in, or?
Let's see. I wonder if we could figure this out easily.
If we were walking about 4 miles an hour, then.
I once did a hike in Virginia in the mountains. We hiked 8 miles and it almost killed us because it was up the hill and down a hill. And it took us all day. Okay. Now, you guys, you're not necessarily going up these steep hills like that was, but there are hills. There are moments where the terrain changes. You might see a ridge line, creeks you might have to cross over, and you're burdened down with some gear to last you 4 to 5 days. So.
Okay. We're watching what we're doing so that we, you know,
yeah. Okay.
We know, you know, carelessness in the woods is not a good thing.
Okay.
Are we managing to, are we still seeing signs of this blood?
So give me another track roll.
Okay.
And you all can do it. That's fine. Because you're all
looking the
same thing. Yeah, exactly.
No way.
Oh, nine.
I apparently found some more bear crap. I think this might be a bear. There's a bear involved in this whole thing.
So you manage to see where it breaks off from the road, and it doesn't go too far into the woods. It's almost as if... Well, give me an idea, Ron.
Oh, I got that one. 19.
Okay. It's almost as if you can tell that the bad guy, for lack of a better word, that he was like traveling down the road, and then it all of a sudden hit him that, you know, oh, maybe I should try to change my route and try to lose people in case they are tracking me.
Ah.
Let me look around this area though to see if there's any signs of the girl.
There have been no signs of the girl.
Sneaky bastard. I've got one. Is there a sign of how many people there might be? Footprints? Mm. Anything in the... Is there any mud near the river? Or...
Good point.
Give me a track roll, and I'm going to say that you're either going to have to make a hard and extreme.
I apparently found more.
All of us.
Yeah, you all can do that because that's okay. You probably would have mentioned that out to everybody.
Oh, look, a squirrel.
Squirrel.
I'm looking at the sky.
Well, watch out. If you're looking up at the sky, you're going to step right in this bear.
I'm not everywhere down. I'm not looking at tracks.
Okay. All right. So. Several hours go by. You've managed to... There are times where you kind of lose the trail, but with your diligence, you can backtrack, you can pick up where you last saw it, and you're able to see, pick up the trail again and continue on. It's pretty much, you're still following the blood trail. There are signs, you know, broken twigs that tell you that, you know, you're on the right path, basically.
Does this trail look as though they're heading in a particular direction, or is it changing quite a lot as though they're just panicking and running?
Also, is the blood getting fresher, or is it staying constantly in an old state, or does it look like we might be gaining?
Okay, that's a good question. At this point, it's hard to tell. It all kind of looks the same.
Right.
What was your question again? I'm sorry, Chester.
My question was, does it look like they're heading in a specific direction, or does it seem more like they're changing direction a lot and just panicking and running?
Initially, it looked like they just panicked and ran. But now, like I said, it was pretty much like they're kind of following this logging trail road, other than parts where it heads off into the woods one direction. But then usually after, you know, 20 minutes or so, it's... They managed to get back onto the logging trail again.
Given my sort of native experience of the woods as a local, do I have a kind of rough idea of where they're heading?
Give me an idea, Ron.
No, I've just missed that.
Well, I'll pull out my compass and see which direction we're heading in.
You pretty much are following the road, and the road is heading northeast.
All right. So I'll let everybody know we're still heading in a sort of northeastern direction. Would you guys have any idea of what's out here?
Well, if we're heading northeast from Bennington, that's going to take us up the mountain.
Hmm.
And like that, northeast of Bennington, this is just a huge, huge woodland area. There's nothing out there for miles.
I'll ask, how far does this forest go? How many miles?
It actually goes all the way to Canada.
Okay.
The three locals, give me an idea roll.
Yep.
One of the rumors from the town that's always been in the background is that a long time ago, there were rumors that this area was traveled by people looking to escape to Canada from the Civil War, but trying to avoid conscription.
So this is where the Civil War deserters headed, this direction.
Right.
No one's going to find them in the end.
Makes sense. I mean, if they've got the money and everything's gone wrong for them, trying to get over the border.
Now their ghosts are haunting the woods because they're lousy, corrupt cowards.
So you're traveling along. There's certain times where you're kind of like, it's actually a nice day out. You're kind of enjoying a walk in the woods. Mm-hmm. And then it hits you again, like, oh, yeah, I'm out here for a reason. And but it is a nice day. You see the occasional deer or the squirrels running around. Everybody give me a listen roll, please.
Nope.
Yes.
No.
Oh, just missed it.
Chester, you're kind of, is it safe to assume that you're sort of taking point since you have the hunting background specifically?
I think so. I think I've kind of taken over the tracking, really. So,
I mean, I know you kind of described that you're kind of spread out a little bit, but I'm picturing more of like a V, maybe. Like, you kind of are, you know what you're doing. You're not really wasting a lot of time like looking around in spots where you know there wouldn't be any signs. Mm-hmm. So. Up ahead, maybe 50 yards, you hear something in the woods, and it's loud enough to give you pause.
What's the matter, Chester?
I've just heard there's something up there. What sort of sound was it? Was it just like something moving or something breaking? Or?
Sounded kind of like a twig snap, but like maybe a larger twig.
I'm just going to sort of motion to the others to just hold back a second.
Crouch down a bit, so I'm a small.
I'm going to just sort of move back to the others very quietly and just. I think there might be someone up there. I mean, it could be an animal, but I've just heard something up there.
Can I try to scan the woods to see if I see anything?
So what we can do is everybody can give me a spot hidden, but those that didn't hear it, which is pretty much everybody except Chester, you're going to have to make a hard.
I didn't make a hard, but I know.
I've made it. Okay. Actually, I made it as a hard as well.
Okay, excellent. You see a flash of red.
Like a color red or a light red?
Color.
Light?
Color, like the color red.
Oh, something red.
Right.
Red in the woods, see?
Yes. Guys, hunter mode. Get down low and...
Get slinking, yeah.
City boy, get down.
I'm down.
Yeah, as though in much the same way I would if I was moving towards a deer, I'm just going to sort of I'm not approaching it, but I'm just going to sort of creep forwards a bit just to try and get a better look. to see if I can just sort of position myself somewhere where I can see a bit better through the foliage and get a better idea of what I'm looking at.
Okay. Give me a stealth roll.
Okay. And I sort of grab Murphy and I say, watch where you step. Watch for twigs, watch for sticks. Any kind of noise, be quiet.
Says the man who stepped in three piles of bear shit.
I didn't step in them. I saw
he did.
He just chose to step in them. I get it.
He's just camouflaging his scent. That's what
there you go. I'll start calling you shitty boy instead of city boy.
Shitty boy. We would do.
Can you keep the bears away, though?
Stealth rolls, Chester? Is anybody else following him?
Yes. No, because I haven't heard anything, so I'm just looking around, pointing the gun, and crouching down.
Okay.
I say, also be careful.
No.
I think I have not
made that stealth roll. Okay.
I was going to say that there are other people out here looking, so...
Right.
Yeah.
I think, though, that the second we saw him sort of act like he'd heard something or seen something, we all act we act the same. Because
yep.
It could be a search party, but my initial thought is that if that was a local out searching in the woods, a local out searching in the woods would know not to wear red in the woods.
Yeah.
We probably look like a very bad Vietnam film at the moment. We're probably just putting guns everywhere.
Put dirt and mud on your face, like
no efficiency at all.
You managed to get a little bit closer, and it looks like there are two figures up ahead, maybe about 30 yards ahead of you.
Men, women.
Let's just say one's tall, one's short.
Okay. Just a couple of guys up ahead.
It's Abbott and Costello. Oh, wait a minute. They weren't around this time.
And they probably were, but they were on stage.
From where I'm standing, in which direction does the foliage seem to be denser?
We'll say to your right.
Okay. I'm going to try and just sort of move around through the denser foliage.
Okay.
Just again, not necessarily trying to sort of sneak up on them, but just trying to get into a position where I can get just a better view and a better idea of who's up there, particularly just to see if it's, you know, if it's someone local that I would recognize as another search party.
Okay.
Can we see what they're doing?
Give me another. So are you trying to stealth sneakily, or are you, you're just... What?
I'm standing still at the moment, but I'm trying to figure out what they're doing. Are they standing there? Are they building a campfire? Are they, what are they doing?
Are they talking?
Are they talking?
Give me a listen roll.
They're discussing their
aircraft. It's not your night, Al.
How far away are they?
I'm going to say about 30 yards.
All right, so... I see that Chester is moving up. I'm going to have my rifle. I'm going to start aiming. I'll aim for the tall one, just in case they decide to start shooting at him. I'll have him covered.
Okay. Give me a listen roll, Chester.
Okay.
Murphy, don't shoot. They might be locals. Well, not locals, but...
Yes.
I know how to use a gun.
They were wearing red. If they were local, they wouldn't be wearing red.
As you get closer, you can tell it is a man and a child.
Man and a child? A little baby?
A male child or a female
male
child?
Male child.
Male child.
How tall?
Maybe about, 4 feet tall.
Do I recognize either of them?
Seven.
No. Or it could be a midget.
And
this is not a circus.
The clothes they're wearing, are they wearing this the sort of thing that, say, a man and his son would be wearing if they were out in the woods hunting?
You probably would know that. The man is wearing a bright red flannel shirt, and the boy is wearing a bright yellow flannel shirt.
Okay. Hmm. Are they carrying firearms?
Yes.
They are.
It's just a guy out hunting with his kid. Do they look like they live in the woods, or do they look like they're dressed normally?
I would say normal. Are they scraggly? Yeah, normal, I would say.
Okay, I'm going to move back. Which other member of the party is nearest to where I am?
It's up to you guys.
I think Murphy was covering.
I was following Chester quite closely because Chester knows what he's doing, but I wasn't going forward with him.
I'll move back to Lloyd and just sort of quite quietly just say I think it's just some guy and his son out in the woods.
I haven't even seen them yet.
Yeah,
it's just a man and a boy.
Oh,
they don't look like gangsters.
You didn't recognize them?
Don't recognize them. I've not seen them, but it's just a man and a boy. It's not the. Doesn't look like John Diligent to me.
Well, why don't we just
unless the kid is baby face Finlayson.
Everybody, give me a luck roll, please.
How it spells?
Yes,
yeah, I believe it is. Yes,
luck. I did not make.
The two that failed, give me another luck roll.
Nope.
I made that one.
Okay, as you guys are kind of whispering about your plans, a shot rings out.
From them or from somewhere else?
From them.
Okay.
Hold up. There's people out here.
Are they pointing at us or are they pointing elsewhere?
They shot in your general direction, yes.
Oh. Yeah, it's like, it wasn't
anywhere near you. It wasn't even close. But it was in your general direction. So when you yell that,
And we're going to stand up as well, you know, so they can see where we are.
Okay, gotcha. The man yells out. He's like, whoa, I'm so sorry. And he snatches the rifle from his son's hand.
It's okay. Nobody's hurt.
What are you doing out here?
We go forward, obviously, to where they are.
There's a search on. Didn't you hear? There's a girl's being kidnapped, and
there's a fugitive down here in the woods. You best take your boy and go
back. Yeah, we're not the only search party out here. There's people all over the woods.
Oh wow!
Right now, it's not a good time to be out here.
I'm actually from Boston. Me and my son.
Wow, you're all the way out here in Vermont, huh?
Yeah, we came up here on a holiday. Me and Alistair and his son, we came up to try and teach our boys about hunting.
And Alvin Hitch.
Rule number one, he shakes your hand, and he turns to his boy, and he's, rule number one, don't shoot at people. And the boy is, he almost looks terrified. Like he realizes what he could have done.
Hey, it's all right, son. Luckily, you're a bad shot. Don't worry about it. You're still
and, he says, my name's Brian.
Murphy. I'll shake his hand from Markham. So not too far from where you guys are.
Hang on one second. Apologies, I flipped the names around. He says his name's Alistair.
Alistair.
And this is my This is my son, George.
And do you have a last name, Alistair?
Lawson. LAWSOM.
Mr. Lawson.
And I'm here with my buddy Brian Hall and his son Arthur.
Where is Mr. Where's Holland?
Well, that's we are actually were on our way out of the woods. My son George, he's not really into the hunting thing, it turns out.
What was the son's name? Brian Hall's son's name?
Brian's son's name is Arthur.
Arthur.
So you don't know where they are. Are they up ahead, or are they?
Oh yeah, they should be up ahead. If I had to guess, I mean, they might have moved, but if I had to guess, maybe a day's hike north, northeast.
Wow.
Are we the only people you've seen while you've been out here?
So far, yes.
Have you heard anything?
No, I can't say as I have.
How long have you been out here?
We've been out here maybe 4 or 5 days it's been.
Wow. You haven't heard anything. Are you been in this general area, or have you been wandering around?
Pretty much. We found that the further we got into the woods, it seemed like there was no game. So we've been sticking around this one area.
Well, we're just at the beginning of deer season, so you're not going to find too much at the moment. But my suggestion is that you head in this direction. Where did you enter the woods? Did you?
There was a clearing. There was a clearing out there.
And I mean, how'd you get there? You have a car?
We left our car at the inn.
Oh, what kind of car?
Chrysler.
I'm a mechanic, by the way.
Chrysler.
He says, well, I would suggest if you can head yourself back to the car, either that or head into Bennington and get a ride out to your car.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you for telling me about that.
Where's this clearing that you're speaking about?
It was just on the edge of town, basically. I think it was this logging road. We pretty much followed the logging road back in.
You followed more or less the same way we came in.
Oh, okay.
We're gonna look for your friend Brian and Arthur and tell them the same thing.
Yes, please do. I mean, if they're in trouble, I hope you can get word to them. Brian,
when you go back down to town, you might want to just let the sheriff know that your friend's out there.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay.
And this is going to seem like an odd question, but just so that we recognize him, what are they dressed in?
That's a good question, Brian. I don't think you'll be able to mistake him. He's wearing a big white cowboy hat.
White cowboy hat. What sort of clothes is he wearing?
They're just in bright colors too, for being hunting season.
Looking at the cowboy hat would probably be enough to give me one.
And his son?
Same yellow shirt, flannel shirt.
He's wearing the yellow.
Yep.
Is the dad wearing the red?
Yeah. I know. We kind of look alike.
Okay. We'll do what we can. But you should head out. This is dangerous in here right now.
Okay. I appreciate it.
And make noise.
Yes, we will. A lot of
other search parties out there.
We will definitely do that.
Can I give them some directions? Try and get them onto the logging road as quickly as possible.
Sure, there would be.
I think they'd be much safer on the logging road than walking around in the woods. I think.
Yep.
Now, while these guys are talking, I do want to get a certain feel. For this father and son, like, are they on the level with us? So I do want to do a quick psychology roll while they're talking.
Absolutely.
See if I see any sort of ticks.
Absolutely.
And I don't make that. Never mind. So I don't.
Well, I will say you've already noticed that the son appears
shaken.
Nervous, shaken, afraid almost.
A boy who's learning how to shoot. I cried the first time I killed a squirrel.
I didn't make it, but this might be another question. I don't know. I'll pose it. Does the boy look like he's nervous because he almost shot us, or does he look like he's nervous because he's with somebody that he doesn't know?
If you can think of a good justification to push the roll, I'll let you re-roll it.
Okay. My justification is just to make sure that, I mean, we're coming across somebody that's a stranger that hasn't heard anything. He claims that he's been out here hunting. Okay. He's just basically wearing just that. He doesn't have like a backpack and sleeping gear or anything like that with him, does he?
They do. They have, it looks like okay. His story holds up about the 4 to 5 days thing.
Okay. All right, well, then there's no need for me to push it. I'm just looking, observing.
Well, I think you justified it enough, so if you want to. Now, there might be a small negative consequence, but I don't think it'll affect.
No.
So the consequence is that the father sees you kind of eyeballing his boy and just gets a little nervous.
Okay. All right. I'm just going to say, just be careful out there. Make sure you don't shoot anybody. Like I said, we were saying, we have other search parties out here looking.
Yes. And he says, thank you very much for your information and your help.
All right.
And he starts to watch your step.
Watch your step, because there has to be a ton of bear shit out here. This one, and I point over to Al. Can't seem to not step in.
It's a gift.
And you hear them walking through the woods, and they're actually like just singing a song out loud so that people will hear it.
Cool.
And I think with that, we have run out of time.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Okay.
It went very, very snappily. So.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. It's a good sign.
Okay. So the episode ends there. Our players included Mick Swan, Simon Ward, Wayne Worthy, and myself, with Chef Wilkins as the Keeper of the Secrets. Our games are played using traditional tabletop methods, with music and sound effects added in post-production in order to create a richer listener experience. This is Tom Raley inviting you to journey with us once again into the darkness for another adventure into the universe of H.P. Lovecraft and the Call of Cthulhu role-playing game. Until next time, good luck and good gaming.